because it tends to be very busy. Everybody goes out and has a couple margaritas and gets behind the wheel.
Any type of holiday like Labor Day, 4th of July, Cinco de Mayo, when it hits hard.
It's Cinco de Mayo today. I think the record is 35 emissions, so if the weather turns out nice, it's going to be a pretty crazy shift.
The Memorial Hermann is a level one trauma center, and we're one of the busiest trauma centers in the country.
We admit 600 to 700 patients a month.
The chance to be with patients on their worst day is just a nice thing to be a part of.
Surgeons here at Memorial Hermann Hospital. It's Cinco de Mayo on Sunday in Houston, Texas. It should be a great day of trauma. So here I am, getting ready to start the day.
Are you guys all secure for it?
All secure.
He's riding a motorcycle. Drove off the road into a ditch. Painted the middle of his back.
Get a chest x-ray. I'm Dr. McNutt. I'm the trauma surgeon on stage, okay? You're pretty banged up, but we're going to do our best to take good care of you, okay?
Okay.
All right.
Okay, good. Let's lift that arm up. Let's get the chest prepped, draped. This needs to be a quick chest tube, not elective, all right? So this is an elderly man who was riding a motorcycle. He was in a pretty bad crash, and it's not looking very good right now. All right, chest x-ray is good. Sew it in, roll him, and scan him. He had a pneumothorax on the right, which is when your lung collapses secondary to chest trauma. So we had to emergently put a chest tube in to re-expand his lung. Yeah, CC head, C spine, chest abdomen, pelvis.
Okay.
We don't really have any other external signs of trauma, so now we will take him to the CAT scanner and see what else he's injured.
Can we give us 50 of fentanyl, please, for me also?
Got two level one traumas back to back here on Cinco de Mayo.
Our department before they put him back forth that it's a quarter size hole and you can see the skull.
Uh-huh. Okay.
Apparently, according to bystanders, he was struck in the back of the head with a hammer, and so he has a quarter size opening just beyond the left ear with the skull exposed.
I don't think this is going to close with staples, but we can probably put a couple of vertical matches to a nylon sutures in there. Sorry, bud. I know. Okay, we can put him down. So you might have a skull fracture. You got a broken head. Apparently a gentleman that was arguing with a friend, which resulted in a hammer to the head. I don't know, you can't make this up. There's nothing emergent in this guy. We'll let radiology read his films. He does have a penetrating wound to his posterior skull on the left side. And he also has some displaced teeth. So we'll also take him to the scanner in a second to see if he has any underlying brain injury. Yeah, head, face, C-spine, chest, abdomen, pelvis.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. Happy Cinco de Mayo.
pain because you feel almost the same pain as they do. So we intubate him, that way we can give him even more pain medication. If this patient went by ground to the hospital, it would take at least an hour and a half, maybe 2 hours. So in that amount of time, the patient could have easily bled out from his wound, or he could have gotten so tired from being in so much pain and screaming that he could have gone unconscious. They brought him straight to a pediatric surgeon. They were able to take him to surgery, start him on some heavy-duty antibiotics. I see hardship, I see things that I can't change, but then on the opposite end of that, I turn around and see where I've made a direct impact, where if I hadn't done what I did for this patient, they would have died.
Control, 25-2, ready for departure, from the water, from the hospital, ready for more speed of the mile.
I'm Ron Verado. I'm a trauma surgeon. I'm originally from Louisiana and moved here about 4 or 5 years ago.
If I have to get out of bed, I'd rather be coming to do something that's adrenaline generating as opposed to sitting at a desk. This is 60-some-odd-year-old male involved in motor vehicle collision. He was moderate speed, had a femur fracture that's open.
He said, yes, he has everything, and then he said, no, he doesn't.
He's on something. This guy had an open femur fracture that was dislocated in the field, and apparently at the scene, on his own, without any additional medication, reduced his own femur fracture back, and so it's actually in place right now.
One, two, three.
Looks like cocaine on us.
Yeah.
Some sort of amphetamine.
He may be in DKA.
He doesn't strike me as a Molly.
Molly is the new ecstasy.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
There's nothing new about... That
mean?
Name has been around for a long time.
Just put a song
about it doesn't make it new.
Cinco de Mayo is all about volume. It's a significant increase in the types of trauma pattern, and you start losing track of when the day started and when it finished.
So now we're in the ER scanner room with our elderly motorcycle patient that's taking blood thinning medications. Hopefully for this man, we don't find anything life-threatening.
You think thoracic aorta is okay. Heart looks all right. Kidneys that we can see look fine, and what I've seen of the liver looks okay. Right. 75-year-old fall, UCA 6, GCS 8.
So we just finished scanning the elderly motorcycle patient. He looks pretty good. Now it's on to the hammer to the head guy. We need to rush into the scanner, see what's going on with him before our next trauma patient gets here. This is my Cinco de Mayo. Where's my margarita?
Coming up on Life Flight.
30-year-old male.
He's got one hole here and one hole just below the shoulder blade.
And later.
He sustained a puncture wound to his chest, and reportedly he's losing a lot of blood. We need to get him to the hospital really fast.
Watch out, Cinco de Mayo. Catfish coming for you.
So, yes, it's the 5th of May, otherwise known as the Cinco de Mayo here in Texas, and so we just brought the 5th patient in about 30 minutes.
Family reports that this guy's normally takes care of himself and is alert and oriented. He has a little bit of trouble walking. Sure. Mm-hmm. When we arrived there, he had bleeding from his ears.
Yep, okay.
So we just brought in a patient who was a fall, had a lot of bleeding coming from his ears, so they're going to take him over the scanner here shortly and see where the bleed is, but I'm pretty sure he's got some sort of bleed in his brain.
You going to intubate him up there?
Yeah.
Are always crazy around here. You know, as trauma surgeons, we expect a holiday to be busier than most days. You get a lot of sick patients all at the same time. Days like this do put stress on the system, but we handle it because that's what we're here for. That's our job.
Young male, gunshot wound to the chest, came in by Life Flight just a while ago. He's got one hole here and one hole just below the shoulder blade. Got a chest tube, and that drained out a lot of fluid. And taking to the CAT scan to kind of better orient how much of an injury the guy's got. And sure enough, he's contused his lung pretty significantly. We're going to take him upstairs to the operating room, drain his chest out, and through a formal thoracotomy.
All right, sports fans, let's get started.
All right, so we're going on the right side of your coffee. This right side is up. Is everybody drinking?
All right, so this guy shot himself earlier this evening, and we're going deep into his chest. He's got some internal bleeding in there, probably from the lung, maybe some of the big vessels. So once we make the incision on his chest wall, we'll spread the chest wall real wide and open so we can see stuff. We'll start looking at the lungs, the heart, all the blood vessels in there, and see where the problem lies. Time is urgency, and those guys on Life Flight, those guys and girls are just ridiculously talented. This guy's got a lot of bleeding, and it's coming from a real high part of the lung. We're pretty concerned about him bleeding to death. Use a fit of shuttle on that one. And get a right angle on that. Finally, I think we got control of things here. He's got some large torn vessels on the back of his lung and on the back of the rib cage there that caused most of the problems. He actually broke off one of the ribs from the gunshot wound, and it kind of pierced into his lung. That was causing a lot of the bleeding that we didn't see. We ligated and tied him off. You know, tied off those vessels with some silk suture. Yeah, don't want to jinx ourselves, but he's looking pretty good, and I think we're going to be able to get out of here okay.
Life Flight 483, this is going to be your response for Winnie. Entering a motorcycle accident. Yes, sir, working up an ETA for Chambers County. It's going to be south of...
Start my shift here on Cinco de Mayo. Heard that all the bases have been real busy today. Seems like it's going to be one of those days, but I'm ready.
Watch out, Cinco de Mayo. Catfish coming for you.
Carol, I'm en route to a motorcycle crash. When I got to stand, the guy ran his motorcycle head first into a ditch. Not sure what injuries he's going to have, but we'll take care of it when we get there.
Currently, his patient's in critical condition. He sustained a puncture wound to his chest, and reportedly, he's losing a lot of blood. Blood pressure's already low. So we're going to try to make it a real short scene time. We need to get into the hospital really fast.
Coming up to 100%. Just let me know when you're all secure and ready to pick up. Thanks a lot. Y'all have a good weekend. Yes, sir. We appreciate it. Y'all have a safe trip home.
Control by 4 lane, Irma, 2 minutes.
We're on the aircraft on pad 1.
So he just arrived here in shock trauma 2. It took us about 12 minutes or so to get here. Dr. Tyson is in there. He's on call. He's taking care of him. And they'll work together along with the trauma team and get him taken care of. Hopefully he'll make it through it.
So this gentleman will need surgery. On the ultrasound, we saw a little bit of fluid around the heart. A little bit of fluid is okay. Can be normal. But in this case, it doesn't take a whole lot of fluid to cause what's called pericardial tamponade, which can prevent the heart from beating and kill somebody. Hey, bud. Dr. Tyson, I'm a surgeon. We've done this a lot of times before. You're going to be just fine. I know it's hard to relax with all these people around you, but just try to close your eyes. And
you just take that off. I'll be all right.
All right, we'll take care of that. Don't worry. You see a hemostat? Are you in the pericardium? I'll make yourself a bigger hole. I can feel you pushing above, but I don't feel actually feel. I think you're hitting the roof. Yeah, I hurt my roof. I don't feel any defect in the anterior pericardium. This is negative. No injury to the heart.
Staying calm is very, very, very important, particularly on Life Flight. You know, we see a lot of bad things out there. A lot of people hurt really bad. A lot of family members are upset. And they have a reason to be. The loved ones are hurt.
Oh, was I impeding the flow here?
Yeah, you can walk
out. You just need to wait till I go and finish cleaning my stretching to get ready for the next one.
Everyone has a job to do, and they're moving in a certain direction to complete the task that they've been assigned to do. What we do is we like to come in and we have to stay calm.
Trouble.
What happened here? What were you doing?
What, right here? Oh, man. I was, that's back when I used to be a little devil. The horn coming in, all right?
We'll be back with three more. We keep it moving.
What you call that? High speed, low drag? Huh? Is that your terminology?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so that's what it is. We keep it moving. We're back up. We're ready to go. Cinco de Mayo. About to go get us another one.
Coming up on Life Flight.
Do you want to put us on ER divert?
Yeah, ER divert. Cinco de Mayo is living up to my expectation. The ER is at capacity and more patients on the way in. And later.
34-year-old female held up like a GSW and she's been down for about 40 minutes.
Cinco de Mayo. Killing me. Damn it.
So I'm halfway
halfway through my 24-hour shift now, and Cinco de Mayo has been very busy. You know, the whole team has been working overtime to take care of all of the patients. And unfortunately, Cinco de Mayo isn't different than any other holiday, when it's just full of temptation and bad decision-making when you find yourself as a trauma patient here.
Where are y'all
going? Do you want to put us on ER divert? Yeah. ER divert. ER diversion means that the ER is swamped and they need a few hours to get patients out of the ER to make room for more. And we're getting orders and calling the sticky to get our guy out of here. The first thing I did with the elderly gentleman that was in the motorcycle accident, once we got him out of the scanner, I said, write orders and get him out of here to the sticky, because then that frees up another bed in the ER to make room for more patients.
When we go on trauma divert and patients don't come here, mortality in the city of Houston goes up. Our goal is to not go on divert, and we try to keep that less than 1% of the time.
Cinco de Mayo is living up to my expectation. The ER is at capacity, and we have a lot of sick patients down here and more patients on the way in.
Control, I'm my 7 apart.
Multi-helicopter scene. This means that they have at least 2 helicopters so far. Sounds like that at least 2 patients right now. Who knows what we're getting into?
There is a baby one, I know for sure. I don't think the second one will be intubated.
Okay, the first helicopter that's there should take the intubated patient. We will take the other patient. We're only 6 minutes away.
Yeah, I think that's fine.
Summer holidays, if the day shift is busy, guarantee the night shift should be twice as busy.
Pinned in
for approximately 15 to 20 minutes. Unknown history, may have allergies. Re-trapped
in the car.
I figure
somewhere probably around 18 years old. Head injury, got bruising on the pelvis.
Car was hit on the side. Either we ran a stop sign or something happened.
You know, they were just going home or maybe gone and had dinner together.
From the story we got, this was not their fault. We see a lot of young kids at sort of 16 to 18 range get injured in car wrecks. It upsets me because my daughter just turned 15, and in a year, she'll be driving. Could easily be my daughter and her friend.
So everybody's done a great job down here in the ER. We're really moving patients out, making room for more to come in, and now we're finally off ER divert, which is perfect because we have 2 patients involved in MDC, or motor vehicle collision, and they're on their way to the ER right now.
Hey, the kiddo, he's out of school. I need that job.
Yeah. Any bruising, like,
bruising on his left arm, maybe?
Then?
Hey, it's dark in here.
That look old to you?
Pretty red.
We're taking a younger 2 patients back to Herman. Vital signs are stable at this time. Probably going to repeat an ultrasound here in a few minutes. The big thing right now is time. Covering distance from point A to point B. It's very critical when you have patients that are severely injured like this kid.
Oh.
Does that look like blood, maybe?
It's not part of the bladder.
It's not dark like it normally is.
Well, there's a definite line between it and the bladder, too.
No, it
isn't. He's got stuff bubbling up out of his mouth.
Both good?
Marion said he had a ton of blood.
Give him 2 and 2.
I'll be right back.
Okay.
All right, man. I'll be downstairs.
It's Cinco de Mayo. It's a little bit crazy. The weather's nice. It's generally on the weekends. When you have people use a little alcohol to have some fun, they tend to have more people that wind up here with injuries. Been real busy all day, and you just have to grind it out.
Cinco
18-year-old male.
20-year-old male, NBC.
Front seat, right passenger of a motor vehicle.
Yes, here deported to the left hip.
It looks like an abrasion to the head on the left side.
On a chest and a pelvis, x-ray guns.
It's really critical for us to give as much information as possible. That way it paints a complete picture so they can maybe focus on an assessment more than they thought they needed to.
We've just had two kids come in. They were in a car accident together. On initial presentation, they needed to have their airways protected because their mental status was such that it was altered. I'm concerned about head injuries on both primarily, but also because they can't communicate with me. We've got to make sure they don't have any other bodily injuries that could lead to bleeding and death.
Let's go ahead and roll them while they're doing that. Yeah, pelvis. I don't think that fast is positive. He's got a fairly easy accessible airway.
These two boys were in a horrific car wreck. It's hard to imagine that the person riding right next to you in a car is severely injured like these two guys are. I feel bad for these guys. They got a long night ahead of them. I mean, they're going to be here for hours. And, you know, they don't know what's wrong with each other. I mean, one guy's in one room, one's in the other.
Based on what was described as seeing, concerned about a head injury. He had some issues with his airway.
We're going to image both of these patients and look for any potentially lethal injuries. What I'm concerned about is head injury and obviously internal injuries that could cause further bleeding. Oh. Call neuro.
Life flight. This job is difficult on everybody. We all have the same goal. We're all trying to save lives here.
The idea is teamwork. Sometimes they've done all they can, and we pray for a good outcome, and we don't always get it.
And later.
We
have to stop bleeding and stop spillage, and the time to accomplishing those goals determines whether or not a patient lives or dies.
We've just had two kids come in. They were in a car accident together. One of them, fortunately, does not seem to have severe injuries. He'll go ahead and go up to the ICU, but he should be fine. The other I'm very concerned about. He has a bad head injury with severe bleeding on the brain. We'll need to get neurosurgery involved.
What's the word?
The lungs look pretty bad.
The spleen looks irregular right there.
He's bleeding there.
From the spleen.
Thank you. So this patient has two potentially life-threatening injuries. One is the head injury, and one is the bleeding in the spleen. That's real. Spleen, we'll go ahead and take him to the operating room first and get the spleen out, because further bleeding will only make his head injury worse.
Okay, hold on a second.
So I'm going to take him.
You want to take him?
Because he's got extrav in his spleen, and it's right next to the colon. I want to make sure it's not from the mesentery.
That's
the
Sierra?
Well, he's going to the operating room. Yeah, so he's got active extract from the spleen and from his right adrenal. Neurosurgery will meet us in the operating room and do any procedures that they need to do, such as putting in a pressure monitor or potentially draining any blood that's accumulating it on the brain.
He has abdominal injuries. We're going to be doing an exploratory laparotomy and any indicated procedure.
Everybody agree? Agreed.
We're about to open his belly and see, make sure he's not bleeding to death.
Starting.
Blood time. Refresh. 15. Thank you.
All right. Not a ton of blood, but I got to look at his spleen and his colon. You just hold it right there. Right there.
His spleen's coming out. Given his head injury, the best way to stop spleen bleeding is to remove it, so.
Spleen?
So I just got word that the two motor vehicle collision patients from earlier are recovering in the ICU. Although the 18-year-old kid does have significant neurological injury, he is going to live.
He's there, sorry.
He is right here.
And no cardiac activity. What time is it? time of death, 107.
Sorry, good work, though.
This job is difficult on everybody. It's a very stressful environment. We all have the same goal. We're all trying to save lives here. She had a devastating self-inflicted gunshot wound to the head, and she had no pulses and no signs of life on arrival. And so we immediately pronounced death. And I know that's difficult because, like I said, Kelly and Lifeline were working feverishly, sweating, doing chest compressions, doing everything possible to get the patient here alive, but we just couldn't save her.
Yeah, there's been days where I thought this was horrible. There's absolutely no rhyme or reason to make this happen.
You're doing okay? You're doing all right?
The idea is teamwork, you know, from emotional and physical support. Sometimes they've done all they can, and we pray for a good outcome, and we don't always get it.
Yeah, the back of the aircraft is going to take a little while.
We will hurry.
We'll be ready when you're ready. How about that?
Sometimes you just, everything you do won't make a difference. At the end of the day, I mean, sometimes you lay in bed at night and you think about that patient, and there's nothing that you can do to make it go away. You're just going to think about him.
Anytime you add a holiday, poor decision making, you're going to end up in the ER. And there's a good chance you're going to get a ride there from us.
ET2's in good position. We need more on the left, on that chest. I need an oral gastric tube. This lady had a motor vehicle collision. We commonly call it a T-bone, where her vehicle was struck on the side by another vehicle. She lost consciousness and was therefore intubated and is on a breathing machine right now to support her ventilation. And now we're going to go to CAT scan to fully assess the chest, abdomen, and pelvis, mostly looking at the head. It's likely she has a head bleed.
Open skull fracture.
I suspect she had an open skull fracture in addition to a head bleed. So she'll get a neurosurgical consult for the head bleed. Cinco de Mayo is certainly living up to its expectations today. Who shot him, do we know?
He was shot by a few out there, I guess. He punched, allegedly punched the guy in the face, so the guy just decided to shoot him.
This is a 56-year-old gentleman involved in an altercation and has multiple gunshot wounds.
They're trying to give him blood. Bring your hand over here. You got to relax.
The first question is, how much time do we have? We have to stop bleeding and stop spillage. And the time to accomplishing those goals determines whether or not patient lives or dies. She's got the arm and one in the dark abdominal. All right, let's do a chest x-ray.
All right, x-ray chest. Watch your hands.
Penetrating gunshot wounds to the chest and abdomen always end up as being operative cases, so we're getting ready to go to surgery.
Is that the bullet by the heart?
It may be back by the spine, I can't tell. It's hard to get back there between the heart and the aorta without injuring something.
Right?
Let's just bring that to the OR. I don't like his waveform on the heart line. All right, let's go.
This gentleman bleeds, continues to bleed, and can bleed to death.
Coming up on Life Flight.
All right, we're going to be putting some pressure on the heart for a second.
That's the bullet right there. It's lodged in that space right there. I'd say we just leave it.
And later.
Busy Cinco de Mayo night. We've got some staff. It's par for the course. Allegedly punched a guy in the face, so the guy just decided to shoot.
This is a 56-year-old gentleman involved in an altercation outside of a nightclub. He actually had two gunshot wounds. One was to the chest, left chest, and one was to the abdomen. We split up into teams. One team opened the left chest, while simultaneously we opened up the abdomen.
Did you see the diaphragm injury in your shoulder?
I found the bullet.
Do you see a trajectory there from that? That looks like it came from the upper?
It could have. You know, there's no exit in the angle.
I'm going to stop this bleeding here.
All right.
I'm obstructing our field.
All right. All right, so I got my bullet in here. So yours came from that shoulder wound. All right, this is evidence. So I need at least one more. This trajectory is clearly going way down here.
Okay. I think I found a bullet.
Nice. Loosely floating?
No.
Is it in the aorta and you're about to create a huge stream of blood? Don't pull it out until you know what it's in. We identified a gunshot wound to the left chest, a structure that's more challenging to repair. The heart or the aorta, the esophagus. There are lots of vital structures in there. Reach in here. Put your hand on top of mine.
Yep.
All right, now pull all that up for you just for a second. All right, we're going to be putting pressure on the heart for a second. That's the bullet right there. See, it's underneath the corner. It doesn't really make sense.
is lodged in that space right there. I would not even, I'd say let's leave it. Okay. Pretty well fixed in there.
Yeah.
Wow. Pretty damn close.
Hold, Richard.
Yes, he's going to live today. But this is not his first round with trauma.
I'm ready. I'm ready to go, too. I'm doing six tonight. How many are we doing?
Seven.
Three. Oh, we do seven. We fly to seven in the morning. Good night to fly.
Cinco de Mayo, beautiful weather, perfect storm on trauma.
All right, what's the word?
All right, two gunshot wounds, one to the middle of our spine, at the bottom. And he's got another one to the right upper extremity.
Has he been moving his legs?
But yeah, he's wiggled his toes for me and everything. Pedal pulse is plus two, radial pulse is plus two. That one's glued up pretty good. He's got to put some pressure on the right. Instead of hands hurting.
Okay, all right, thanks, man.
This young man, 20-year-old, shot by somebody he knew. His heart rate was kind of low, so that's what we're kind of like thinking. It's a neurogenic kind of thing. So
one, two, three. Any pain where she's touching you?
Right sacrum.
Pain there?
So he'll go to scanner next. I'm Dr. McNutt. I'm trauma surgeon on, okay? We're going to go get a CAT scan of you and see what's injured.
I'm suffering from pain.
What's that?
Can you take away the pain?
We cannot take it away completely, but we can certainly help. All right? Bradycardia. Concerning.
Am I dying?
No, you're not. You have a pretty big injury, though, okay? This bullet got your liver and probably some pieces of bowel. We're going to take you upstairs, put you to sleep, so you won't feel or remember anything we do to you. And we're going to do our best to take care of you, okay?
We have a brief description of what's going on, but most of the time we have no clue, and who knows what we're walking into. If they're combative, sometimes you have to calm them down. Sometimes you have to physically keep their arms down. You're treating more than just physical injuries sometimes.
Kind of nice to get stabbed with one.
We're going to get his airway controlled and get him upstairs to the operating room.
Looks good.
I figured you guys are getting bored. I want to make your night go a little quicker there.
You got any towels up? Got the staples in?
I'll take a towel clip, too. A knife to him and a towel clip to me.
Well, this guy came in just a while ago, got stabbed right there in what we call the box, which is right in the heart, belly region. Chest x-ray downstairs look pretty clean, so I'm going into the belly first. If we're wrong on which cavity to go into first, this guy's mortality goes up significantly.
Coming up on Life Flight.
A little bit of blood down there, but not a whole lot. How long ago? Look at this.
Huh. A lot of injury here, the chest, the belly. Pretty concerning. This guy could die on us tonight.
Like he's still got something here going on the colon. Oh, I smell it still. Yeah, you smell it.
So we had a patient stabbed right in the middle of his abdomen, right in his chest area, and a knife broken off. It's all the way stabbed to his spine. Got a decent amount of bleeding going on here. Really concerned about him. He's actually damaged his colon and his small bowel as well. So we're going to be here for a little while.
How is he doing up top, guys?
Pressure just bottomed out.
Okay.
But his pulse
I don't think it's anything internal. I don't think it's the lung anymore. I think this is just alcohol kind of playing havoc on his system from his Cinco de Mayo celebration. He doesn't, but we're looking at his lung. I mean, it's open. It's decompressed, I assure you. But, you know, he may need his chest open. We'll see. Okay. Yeah, so when they stabbed him, when they broke off the knife, I think they kind of moved it around quite a bit, and they went through the colon and the small valve, but they actually broke the rib right in half. With that, they kind of lacerated the artery and vein that run right underneath that rib, and he bled a decent amount.
Yep, that is, yeah.
Get down in there. Crank it. Cut this in a little bit. Take out the... A little bit of blood down there, but I want to look at this. The problem with some of these cases is as you repair things, you open up one plane and one area of tissue and you go to another and you keep finding more and more injuries. Whoever stabbed him put it all the way in the hilt and broke off the handle. You know, this guy's got a lot of injuries with both bleeding and with the colon and small bowel all the way down the spine. Before you know it, we can turn around and anesthesia can tell us they've lost him. Huh. Nothing there, right? Looks pretty clean. Happy with that? Okay. For the little PDS and then oversew with Limber.
Yeah.
Okay, 3-0?
Yeah.
3-0 PDS. So far, it doesn't look like we have any bleeding. We have a hole through the colon and the small bowel. So we had to take out a big section of his colon from where he had torn across it, messed up the blood supply and everything. Had to take care of some big bleeding vessels in that area. But again, he's got some redundancy there, got lots of other vessels coming in. And then we had to take care of the small bowel and even some bleeding vessels around the spine. But again, we're doing okay here. Very satisfied with the result. Looks like he'll be celebrating another Cinco de Mayo.
The end of my shift, and it looks like I survived. We had those four level one traumas all at the same time, all pretty sick. Did a good operation, and I saved that young man that suffered the gunshot wound. I guess it's time for me to go home and have a margarita like the rest of Houston, Texas has done today.
Those nights, they're just absolutely brutal. You have the perfect mix of advertised alcoholic holidays with days off.
So I managed to survive another Cinco de Mayo. We flew, of course, back to back all night. You know, I'm physically and mentally, emotionally drained. I'm, you know, that's a good feeling. Knowing that I've helped somebody now who's going to be having more time with their family.
We're going here, bud. You're in the ER now. Walking into the ER, okay?
Well, another successful Cinco de Mayo. It's been a long night. I've got my cup of coffee to get me safely home. We've had 35 cases today, so I guess we'll start looking forward to the 4th of July now. Today's end of our shift in Cinco de Mayo. It's been a long day, lots of calls. We've been going and going. We're happy to get that young boy here with the severed foot as an example. And it never ceases to amaze me what our medical crews and our doctors can do here for the people we transport. Today's over, but tomorrow's another day, and we'll be ready.
It's one after the other, and just when you think you're going to catch your breath, the next transfer comes in, and it can just be a total ass whipping. I'm going to go home and sleep. If any of my kids are awake, maybe I'll have breakfast with them. And then I'm going to sleep for a while. And then come back and do it again.
I can get you out there. Yeah. I love being a trauma surgeon.
All right, prepare to go down.
Yeah. I never know what I'm going to get myself into when I wake up in the morning, and it's always exciting. I really can't think of anything I don't love about what I do.
We're going to take you upstairs, put you to sleep so you won't feel or remember anything we do to you. And we're going to do our best to take care of you, okay?
Can do to each other is truly disgusting.
I like doing surgery. I think it's the most fun you can have with your clothes on.
Troy Coke, pleased to meet you.
You don't really pick this, it chooses you.